So my name's Frank Smith. I'm here. I'm the director of the No More Epidemics campaign. And I'd like to welcome you all here on behalf of Management Sciences for Health, the International Medical Corps, the African Field Epidemiology Network, and Save the Children, and also on behalf of the Ebola Private Sector Mobilization Group, for the launch of the No More Epidemics campaign. Over the next hour, we'll have a chance to hear from some very eminent speakers to understand a little bit more about the issues, and I'm sure you'll find it very interesting, and if there's any questions at the end, we can take them. We're going to start off with a short film, and I think that that will set the scene for the next hour, and we can start proceedings. Thank you.
Looking back at global health over the last few decades has changed my reaction to the word impossible.
Today, the world celebrates the eradication of this dread disease.
Today, 15 million people are on life-saving HIV treatment.
Today, the World Health Organization can say that the SARS outbreaks have been contained worldwide.
People said impossible. Impossible to eradicate smallpox, impossible to treat AIDS, impossible to get rid of SARS. They all happened because somebody said, we're going to do the impossible, and then they made it happen. No More Epidemics is a five-year campaign to bring together civil society, the private sector, and academia to work collaboratively with governments, with multilateral organizations like the World Health Organization and World Bank, to ensure that we're all better protected from the threat of epidemics. We're going to have local outbreaks, but major epidemics can be prevented with good surveillance, with early detection, and with prompt response. What we've seen over several decades in global health is that when the headlines go away, the attention goes away. History tells us that if we don't have a continuing effort to shine the light on epidemic preparedness, if there's not some sort of outside accountability, we risk falling back into a situation where next time around we're not any more prepared than we were this time around. I judge our impact on how many lives we've saved, on how many places we've touched, and I have so often seen people take on major challenges that folks thought were impossible and have a huge impact. And we can do that with this campaign.
Welcome Jono up, who will be saying a few words and introducing our speakers, and then we can start a panel discussion. Jono, thank you.
Thanks very much, Frank. After seeing that, I was just thinking to myself, maybe we should quit while we're ahead. Nothing, because there's no editing on what happens right here, so there's an advantage. But good morning. Good morning. And I'm really excited to have everyone here this morning. And as I think you may sense, the idea of no more epidemics, of keeping local outbreaks from becoming major global epidemics and pandemics, that's something that we've got a lot of passion about. Why? Why have MSH, the African Field Epidemiology Network, Save the Children, the International Medical Corps, the Ebola Private Sector Mobilization Group, and others, why have we come together on this campaign? After four decades in global health, I'm hard-pressed to think of many issues that have generated so many international headlines, so much fear and panic, and so much high-level involvement and analysis of lessons learned in such a short time, as Ebola did. So with all of this, why in the aftermath of the epidemic in Ebola are we launching the No More Epidemics campaign? And to look at this, I want to look, to answer this question, I want to look back on the history of epidemics and give the backstory of those three examples. For thousands of years, smallpox ravaged humanity, disfiguring people, blinding people, killing millions. By 1949, the U.S. and a lot of other high-income countries had eradicated smallpox. The discussion among global health leaders about eradicating it worldwide started in 1951. There were three world health assemblies where the global health leaders came together to talk about smallpox eradication over 15 years. And in 1966, they finally voted, and the vote only carried by two ballots, to eradicate smallpox. After talking for 15 years, a legendary public health leader, D.A. Henderson, led a campaign that eradicated smallpox in a decade. Who could oppose smallpox eradication? Well, for one, Dr. Marcelo Candão, who was the head of the World Health Organization, he had spent a career in public health believing that smallpox couldn't be eradicated. He lived in Brazil. I mean, he was from Brazil. He knew there were a lot of indigenous people in the Amazon, and he couldn't imagine how to immunize them, and it never occurred to him you didn't have to immunize everybody on the planet. How many people do you think died while the World Health Organization, the world health leaders, were having that 15-year conversation? 30 million people. 2 million people a year, mostly the poor and voiceless in Asia and Africa. AIDS was identified in the 1980s. By the year 2000, it had become a chronic disease in the north. The hospitals had been emptied just in 3 years with highly active antiretroviral treatment. But leaders like the president of South Africa and like the head of the U.S. Agency for International Development did not believe the treatment was either worked or was possible on this continent. Thanks to courageous advocates like Zaki Achmat, who is legendary here with the treatment access campaign, they changed that, and that was a tipping point. Within 10 years, by 2010, there were 9 million people on HIV treatment, most of them on this continent, and today they're 15 million. SARS was the first new epidemic pathogen of this century. It came out of China. It smoldered in China for several months and then flared up. In April of 2003, the former head of CDC, Jeff Copeland, was in Hong Kong, which was one of the affected countries, and the media asked him if it could be eliminated. He said, "I would be shocked if SARS was eliminated in Hong Kong." 2 months later, Hong Kong was declared SARS-free, ahead of Toronto, Beijing, and Taiwan. And as you heard from Gro Brundtland, the Director General, within just a matter of months, SARS was eliminated and has never come back. So the history of epidemics is filled with dithering, like smallpox, denial, like AIDS, a delay, as we saw with Ebola. But the history of epidemics is filled with the stories like those you've just heard of heroes like D.A. Henderson, like Zaki Achmat, like David Heyman, who was the one who actually mobilized, a tenacious WHO leader who mobilized the SARS response and brought together centers to make that happen. So in these few minutes, I want to convince you of three things. There's a huge cost of inaction. There's been dramatic progress to build on, and weak health systems inhibit progress. So on the issue of the cost of inaction, epidemics have a devastating human and financial and social cost. We already got a sense of that. Well over a half a billion people in the last century. Pandemic influenza killed 50 to 100 million people. Smallpox, 300 to 500 million people. And we have 25 new pathogens just in the last several decades for which we have no vaccine and no medicines. The biggest threat is pandemic influenza. Influenza, although it's the common, it's sort of the spring cold or the fall cold, it's actually the most mercurial and the highest risk pathogen. And Bill Gates has teamed up with the Institute for Disease Modeling and actually looked at what would happen if we had something like 1918. Within 100 days, 800,000 people sick in several parts around the world. That's like a bad year for influenza. 200 days, 33 million people in pretty much every corner of the world. And there's a reference in the launch document. It is amazing to see that. But some experts have said that, and have really looked at it, they painted an even more dire situation. If we had a severe prolonged epidemic of the sort that happened in 1918, where a mutation in the virus basically rendered our immunity useless and we had no vaccines, 180 to 360 million people could die in the first year. So it's a real threat. Like war, more people are affected by the disruption of health services, primary health care, than they are by the epidemic itself. And the data from East Africa shows that. Immunization went down 50%, antenatal care. There was a spike, and they're estimating in some of those countries maternal mortality is perhaps going to double for a period of time, and malaria deaths. The economic disruption. SARS killed about 800 people, cost the world economy about $50 billion. And a major epidemic like the one that I just described, the global impact of that would dwarf the 2008 global financial crisis, which affected millions and millions of people. Unemployment, school disruption, all of that is part of what happens. That's the impact. But after 50 years, over the last 50 years, there's been dramatic improvements and some examples of really dramatic progress in disease prevention. Something that's not talked about much, in the year 2000, WHO created the Global Outbreak Alert and Response Network. They've responded quietly but effectively to 130 outbreaks in 85 countries with 200 partners from around the globe. It works. We have heard a lot about the West Africa Ebola epidemic, which was a perfect storm of development issues, political issues, organizational issues, a few biological issues. There had been 22 previous outbreaks since the Ebola virus was discovered in 1976. The largest number of cases before this, 425. That was in 2001 in Uganda. All but six of the outbreaks previously had less than 100 cases. The highest death toll of all those previous 22 was 280, and that was the first outbreak when they didn't even know what it was. There have been rarely more than 50 deaths at an outbreak. Polio eradication, we're well on the way. This year, so far, less than 100 polio, wild cases of polio. I'll footnote that unless there's been a recent report, but so far, 100, that's the lowest in history. When the polio eradication effort started, it was 500,000 cases a year. In short, we know how to stop epidemics and stop them early. So why don't we? That takes me to the third point and to a lot of what we're going to talk about with the panel, and that is, weak health systems really inhibit the process. And that's public health systems. Public health systems that have the epidemic response, that incorporate the disease surveillance, that are resilient. And it's strong international regulations, the international health regulations, and it's a number of other points that we'll talk about. So huge cost of inaction, a lot of progress to build on, and some real work to do in building health systems that can sustain that progress. So what I'd like to do now is first turn to Dr. David Nabarro, who's going to speak to us by video. David's somebody who comes straight out of the field, not in recent decades, but helped build a health program with DFID, was an executive director at WHO. He was the UN Special Envoy in the late 2000s for avian influenza and is now the Special Envoy for Ebola. He's a UN activist, not a UN bureaucrat, so he'll meet with presidents and prime ministers, and then he'll pick up his cell phone and call the MasterCard Foundation and try to figure out with them how to get money to the health workers in rural Liberia so that they can actually, not health workers, but just community people. So with that, let me turn over to David.
Good day, everybody. Good afternoon. I'm very pleased to be with you today at the global launch of the No More Epidemics campaign, and I'm delighted to be able to join you by video to provide a message. I'm going to speak as a result of my own personal experience with a number of outbreaks in the last 20 years. I'll focus particularly on what I've learnt through the recent Ebola outbreak. I'm not going to go into detail on the outbreak. I want to go straight to four particular findings that I believe are relevant to the campaign that you're involved in. And here they are. Firstly, people and their communities must be at the center and must own issues related to disease outbreaks. And this is because diseases are primarily spread through people's behavior. And communities have to be at the center of preparedness and response to infectious disease. Controlling Ebola only became possible when the response was owned by everyone, when communities realized that holding patients in their homes could lead to the death of entire households. They found innovative ways to separate the infected from the healthy. They established their own ways of introducing quarantine, and this quarantine was fine when it was owned by the communities. So in practice, we find that most success in any outbreak response can be attributed to local ownership and initiatives. My second point is that a whole of government, indeed a whole of society response is required. This means strong leadership from the center of government, engaging multiple sectors and including stakeholders from faith groups, the Red Cross movement, first responder organizations and civil society, led by strong commitment from parliamentarians who are encouraging government to act. The focus should always be on understanding and reducing risk in ways that are backed by a combination of science and experience. In the current Ebola outbreak, presidents of the affected countries themselves started to understand the risk, involved the whole of government, as well as politicians and civil society, and made decisions that were based on an analysis of the realities as well as of projections they were receiving. My third point is that coordination and communication is vital. Those of us who work as technical supporters for the response with different qualifications absolutely have to work together. We must find common direction and maintain collective ambition. It's important that all responders, national and international, speak with one voice, providing commonly agreed guidance and avoiding contradicting messages and confusion in the early stages of the response. And we must be sure that whatever happens, the narratives and the stories we use to describe what is happening can be understood by everybody, whoever and wherever they are, whether it's in local newspapers, community groups, or specialized meetings. My fourth point is that preparedness and readiness pay off. Outbreak prevention requires community-based surveillance of animal and human health. It requires the capacity for rumors to be investigated, data to be analyzed, risk to be assessed, and seriousness to be judged. And the whole population at risk must be covered. Preparedness requires well-coordinated, pre-planned comprehensive systems with clear chains of command, which can be applied when necessary. It also includes reinforced surveillance, rapid deployment, and adequate finance. An international response to future crises will require strong emphasis on what happens in the initial period. First of all, the raising of the alert, and then what happens when the alert is raised. And that's why it's so important that the international community and individual countries need to be ready to respond when an outbreak occurs. So the best way is actually to prevent outbreaks happening at all. And for that, societies need to be enabled to act in ways that help them understand and manage risk so as to prevent disease outbreaks from occurring. And this is the reality. Humankind generally avoids major outbreaks through careful and learned action to prevent the spread of disease. And good science helps us to understand the ways to detect and manage risk. And action always involves individuals themselves, supported by a mix of sectors and stakeholders. Let's maintain that focus in all we do, in all we teach, in all we share, and in all decisions we make. And do let us continue to be prepared, because there will be unexpected outbreaks of new diseases or old diseases cropping up in an unfamiliar form. Being prepared to respond and testing responses through simulation, whether in individual nations, at the community level or at the national level, or across nations and across the world, getting this right contributes to a peaceful and secure future for all people and all nations. It needs our continuous and collective engagement so that we can stay together to be ahead of the next threat. And I thank you, and I wish you the very, very best in your important quest. Good.
With that, I would like to invite the panelists to come up. I'll say a few more words about him, but let me get Dr. Nancy Knight, the country director for CDC, to join us, Dr. Brian Brink, and Professor Lucille Bloomberg, and Carl Manlin. Okay, so let me just do some brief intros. You have the bios. Professor Bloomberg has joined a little bit after that was printed. So, but let me start on my immediate right with Dr. Nancy Knight, and she's currently the country director and the disease, global disease, give me the acronym, because you give me, I got the acronym here.
The country director for CDC.
Yes, that I have, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention in South Africa, the DGHA?
The director for the Division of Global
HIV. Right, okay. But you're also concerned with the global outbreaks.
That's correct, yeah.
Okay. And she comes here after being in CDC Kenya, CDC Nigeria, and is a family physician, Peace Corps volunteer from Lesotho. So we're happy to have Nancy Knight join us. We'll welcome all the panelists once we have gone through. The next panelist, immediately to the left of Nancy, is Carl Manlin. He's got great experience in health systems from work in UNDP and the Global Fund in Congo, Benin, Guinea-Bissau. He has a master's in public administration from the Kennedy School and the L'Ordre de Mérite du Bénin, which is a wonderful honor. He also has the Mo Ibrahim Foundation Leadership. He was also a Mo Ibrahim Foundation Leadership Fellow, which is quite an honor. And in May 2015, he joined Africa Against Ebola Solidarity Trust as the executive secretary. And we'll hear more about that and about the Africa. The Africa Against Ebola group in shortly, and then to Carl's left is Lucille Bloomberg, Professor Lucille Bloomberg. She's the deputy director at the National Institute for Communicable Diseases in the National Laboratory Service here in South Africa.
She's also currently the head of the Public Health Surveillance and Response Division, a consultant on emerging pathogens for the a consultant to the Emerging Pathogen Center on rabies and a number of other diseases. She's a medical graduate from Witwatersrand. She's worked in a whole variety of areas. She has a wide range of interests, and she actually started the outbreak response unit at NICD at the time of SARS and has been involved in response to pandemic flu, to cholera, to Rift Valley fever, to Ebola, and we're really pleased that she could join. And then last but very notable, we're really pleased to have Dr. Brian Brink, who's recently retired as the Chief Medical Officer of Anglo-American, the mining group, after doing that for 33 years. He has been a real pioneer in employee health and thinking about sustainable quality health care in countries such as South Africa. On a broader scale, he chairs the SADC private sector constituency on health and also served on the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria on the board there. So again, we're also pleased. He also is a honoree. He's got an honorary doctorate from University of Witwatersrand. So pleased to have you here. Let's give all the panelists a welcome. So we're going to take a couple different themes and then open it up. So be thinking about your questions. But one of the issues is past epidemics. One of the questions is what do we know from that? And I want to start with Carl. Last week in New York City, Africa Against Ebola received the UN Foundation 2015 Global Leadership Award at the annual dinner. And not everybody, first of all, congratulations for that. That's great. So, Carl, can you first talk to us a little bit about Africa Against Ebola and what the Africa Against Ebola Solidarity Trust is really about?
Good afternoon, everybody.
Are you on?
Sorry?
Is he on back there?
I think I'm on.
Okay.
Okay. I think it's about leadership, and the African Union saw the gap in the response in terms of health workers, and they chose to call on the private sector, not all of them, some of them, to see how collectively we could provide an African response to a global health problem. And this is what happened. 856 health workers have come from 18 different African countries. There was no politics, no bureaucracy. It was a will to do something different to ensure that it doesn't happen again. That's how Africa Against Ebola started. Actually, a year ago in Addis Ababa, there was a meeting where the chairperson called on many business leaders. One of them was, a lot of them are from South Africa, Mr. Masiwa, who's the chair of the trust. Also, Mr. Putuma Nleko, who's the chairman of MTN. They have come together and they've created the trust. And we supported as much as we could the response by the African Union.
Okay, and what can you say a little bit more about the SMS Stop Ebola campaign? That was one of the specific things you were involved in.
The campaign was a way to bring the solidarity of Africans to the response and to ask Africans for the first time, which is the first crowdfunding exercise on the African continent, to donate $1. It was never going to be about the money, but it was about showing signs that actually individuals are willing to contribute to something which affects different parts of Africa, but also the world. So you had people from Chad, Niger, Botswana actually donated through the SMS campaign. So certainly needs to be repeated, and we need to figure out how, but it was a very, very excellent exercise of showing how also mobile network operators that usually compete in the same market were willing to share the same platform at no cost to allow individuals to contribute to the response.
That's great. So Ebola hit the three countries that we hear about the most really hard, Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea, but Nigeria, Senegal, and Mali beat it back. And Nancy, you were in Nigeria at the height of the Ebola epidemic, right?
Yes.
Can you tell us how did they do it? What did they do right in Nigeria?
Sure, I'd be happy to talk about that. Nigeria really was a very significant success story in its ability to address the Ebola outbreak there. The first case of Ebola came to Nigeria in a traveler from Liberia on July 20th of last year. And he arrived in Lagos, a city with a population of about 21 million people. So about 20 times the number of people in Monrovia, where Ebola was continuing to expand. So significant risk with such a large urban population that that he arrived at. Nigeria had not yet started at that point any Ebola response. However, upon his arrival and his presentation to a private healthcare clinic, when they recognized that he was suffering from symptoms of Ebola, they immediately, I think one of the important things was their immediate response to notify more senior officials within the government of a potential case, and then their ability to respond to that. Two critical things that helped them to respond very rapidly. One was their expertise in emergency operations centers and the incident management system. They have existing emergency operations centers for polio eradication within Nigeria since 2012. So they were able to rapidly take not just their expertise in how to set up the system, but the individuals from that response and bring them to Lagos to help set up the emergency operations center there. A large number of those people are the second most important factor, which was their field epidemiology residents and graduates. They have a field epidemiology training program, or FETP, which is based on CDC's Epidemic Intelligence Service program, in which we have here in South Africa as well. And many of those graduates were working in the polio response and were working in other sectors of government at national and local level, and they were able to be rapidly deployed to Lagos. And then the third thing I would say is that they have their own National Public Health Institute. Not only is CDC the US CDC in Nigeria, but they have a Nigerian CDC. And that's the framework under which the response was able to operate and draw in all of the external stakeholders, the multilaterals, the bilaterals, as well as national, state, and local government.
And then how quickly did they stop it? And in the end, what was the death toll?
So in the end, there were a total of 20 cases, 19 laboratory confirmed and one suspected cases, and 8 deaths. And that was between Lagos and Port Harcourt, another large port city that's down in the Niger Delta region.
Pretty impressive. Let's turn now to, let's turn to Lucille. You've been involved in a whole variety of epidemics. Can you kind of pick a couple or whatever, pick a couple that you can share with us, maybe something other than Ebola, and give us a sense of what that taught you about how do we keep the outbreaks from becoming epidemics?
Well, the one thing I can tell you is that the unexpected happens in unusual places at unusual times. And you may predict an outbreak, and it's completely different when it actually happens. And I think the world was waiting for bird flu, and that didn't happen as a pandemic. We had H1N1, which turned out to be not quite as severe as we expected. So the unexpected happens. And I think it's not always the formal systems that inform that you have an outbreak. It's really an astute clinician in a hospital or a clinic who notices something unusual and raises the alarm. And I think it's raising the alarm and recognizing that something is not right. You may not know what it is, that is key. And I think if I looked at not Ebola, but we had a new viral hemorrhagic fever outbreak in 2008 in Johannesburg. A patient was transferred to a hospital here for treatment of what they thought was tick bite fever, which is a commonly treated disease. Patient died as tick bite fever, and 2 weeks later, the paramedic who brought her on the flight to South Africa became ill with a similar illness, and fortunately went to the same physician who recognized this as the same illness, the severity, and in a healthcare worker illness is often a sentinel event that makes people think there's something unusual. And he raised the alarm. So very early on in that outbreak, we were able to respond. We didn't know what it was, but things were put in place to prevent additional cases. We had 5 cases in the end. They were infected quite early in that first and second hospital admission. Eventually, 2 weeks down the line, we were able to identify the causative organism as a new virus. And the outbreak was contained because of the rapid response and an astute physician who noticed something unusual and raised the alarm. Having very good laboratories in Johannesburg at the National Institute, I think is obviously a great value. We worked very closely with the CDC to identify that when you're out in a remote community, there is often a delay because you can't put a name to it. And once you do, things do happen. So that's a good example of one of our outbreaks. I can tell you lots more, but we're not going there.
Yeah, so two real pearls there. One is the speed of detection, and it is incredible. That's where the dithering and delay really matters. And the second is the health worker death as a canary in the mine. And that will get people. That was the thing when WHO moved quickly. It took the Dr. Gro Brundtland, who you saw on the screen, it took her less than 4 hours between the time she got the evidence and the time she issued a global alert without even warning countries first. She just put it out publicly because it was killing health workers and it was crossing borders. So two pearls there. Brian, can you walk? AIDS is a different sort of an epidemic, but also 80 million infections, almost 39 million deaths so far, over a couple decades, kind of at least a decade of denial. And you really stepped forward and set the example with what Anglo-American did to protect the workforce and really go beyond that to communities with AIDS, TB. Can you talk to us about how you decided to do that and how you achieved it?
Sure, yes, and Anglo-American is widely known for its response where we provided antiretroviral therapy for employees. What's not so widely recognized is that Anglo-American had been dealing with HIV infection since 1985. That was 17 years before that first treatment was given. And we were actively involved. We saw this thing coming at that time within our workforce. The prevalence of HIV infection was way below 1%. By the turn of the millennium, up to 25% of the workforce was HIV infected. And we had been busy a long time. I have to say somewhat unsuccessfully in all our prevention efforts and in our research efforts. We sponsored a lot of research. I remember Max Essex coming to speak to our exco about this HIV in Botswana, which he said.
Max Essex, maybe not everybody knows Max.
I don't know from but Harvard, but he was one of the pioneers around HIV infection. And he came to our executive. These are business people who are digging holes in the ground and mining. And he was explaining to them about HIV in Botswana. And he said, this virus is very virulent. And they're going to be big problems. So the business people were getting involved and getting prepared and planning for what might happen. And so the culmination of all of that, when treatment became available, we still had to make a decision within the business. Are we going to do this? And probably the most important message that I could get across is simply this. Don't sit back and wait for someone else to do the job, because it's not going to happen in time for your business. You have to be courageous and ready to go, and you might not have all the information you need. At the time we made the decision to institute treatment, we didn't know exactly what it was going to cost. We didn't know all the knock-on consequences. There were lots of critics. So what happens to these people when they leave your business? Who's going to carry on? What about the families? I had a list of about 50 difficult questions which we couldn't answer, but yet we still went ahead with the decision to provide treatment. Now, in retrospect, looking back 15 looking back 15 years, that was one of the best business decisions Anglo-American ever made, was to provide treatment. It turns out that we got control of this threat to the business, this risk, which actually was a real red risk for the business. We've got control of it such that it's now in green territory. It's a manageable risk. Can't say we've cured it or sorted it out, but we know we can manage it. And what's even more interesting is that all the money that we've spent on providing treatment and all the other activities has benefited us in multiples in terms of savings to the business, in terms of lost time, loss of skills, reduced productivity and whatever. So it actually hasn't cost the business anything. It's actually saved the business money to get on with a really proactive response.
Great. One follow-up, just while we're on looking back at epidemics and experience to date. Nancy, you have dealt with AIDS in a number of countries, in Nigeria, which has a major program, in Kenya. Do you any thoughts on what were some of the key things that you saw happen that really moved forward the response to that epidemic?
Sure. Just to add to some of the things that Brian has said, I think with the HIV response, first of all, maybe from the U.S. government's side of things, we have a very large HIV program through the U.S. government, the President's Emergency Plan for AIDS Relief, which was started under President Bush and is one of the largest, or is the largest response to a single disease in the history of the U.S. government. And we work across many agencies within our U.S. government. I think that's one of the factors, you know, that contributes to our success in helping those host country governments that we're working with. We're able to draw up on the expertise, not only within CDC, but within USAID, within our U.S. Department of Defense, that partners with host country militaries, and the National Institutes of Health and the Health Resources and Services Administration. So I think that's one of the points, again, whether we're talking about Ebola or whether we're talking about HIV, being able to bring together a lot of the expertise and use the strengths of those organizations, be they business organizations, government organizations, or community-based organizations, to a response. I think, of course, the most important thing is, because we're doing this work in other countries, we're not doing it, from my perspective anyway, my job, I'm doing it here in South Africa now, I'm not doing it in the United States, so it really depends upon the host country government, the government of South Africa here, or those other governments that I've worked with, and their the strength of their system, both within their healthcare system as within their leadership. And you've mentioned some of the risks that South Africa experienced previously within the country, but I think certainly most recently, South Africa has really been at the forefront of its movement forward on the HIV epidemic and taking the evidence around HIV, the disease, as well as its own burden within the country, and looking at how they can best address that.
So let me put a question. I haven't warned you on this one, but it just flows out of this. The whole issue of denial, the Harvard did, and rumor, there's a whole literature on rumors and epidemics. There are things that you expect are going to happen. There's going to be blame. There's going to be conspiracy theories. In President Mbeki's case, it was the CIA and the pharmaceutical industry. But those are actually the kinds of rumors and conspiracy theories that people always have. Harvard did a study and estimated, working with South Africa, how many people died because South Africa was holding on to AIDS treatment for a while, and it was about 360,000 is the estimate, which is basically the cost of denial. Could we have gotten on the AIDS epidemic quicker? I mean, I would really urge you to look at this Vox video where you see what happens. I referred to it. It's the video that Bill Gates did with the disease modeling, and you start with one case, and 180 days. 100 days. It's 800,000. Twice that, 200 days. It's 33 million. So it gets exponential. Is there anything that we could have done as a global community to move things quicker to keep AIDS from exploding to now 80,000 people so far been infected? This is on tape, but you can take a do-over.
Yeah, go ahead. Try to deny, because if I can get away with it, and how long can we put it off?
Yeah.
To not actually recognize it and deal with the problem. I think with HIV, you know, denial became unsupportable because people were dying.
Yeah.
And we were lucky enough to have treatment that worked. And people saw that those who were going to die suddenly got better. And in fact, that's not the ideal way to deal with the epidemic.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a bit this, you know, let's not talk about prevention. Give me a good crisis and I'll deal with that. I'll solve the emergency. But that costs you so much more money and so much more misery and suffering. If you can actually get ahead before that stage, but that means coming to terms with denial. You can't pretend it's not there. You can't pretend it's not going to happen. You can't pretend, oh, well, I can wait, you know, another week, another month, another year before we do anything. You've actually got to start acting now.
Other thoughts? Yeah, Lucille.
Yeah. So denial is a very common thing around outbreaks. Outbreaks are bad news. They highlight deficiencies in the system, and they don't bring great kudos for the politicians in power. So they're an important part of why outbreaks are not responded to early. And, you know, I think we can all say, well, you know, if you respond early, you'll have less problems and do it in a better way. But denial is a very key issue. And you have to get out there, tell people what the problem is, what can they do to protect themselves. Otherwise, other people will use that space to their own advantage.
Okay. Carl? You?
I just want to pick on what Brian said about don't sit back for someone else to do it. Because when MSF told the world that something was happening, we all waited for somebody else to say, please go.
Yeah.
And that, in that case, WHO. This is part of denial. If Patrick Sawyer, the Liberian that arrived in Nigeria, had not come in Nigeria by plane, he had come, let's say, in the slums, would we have had the same response? Mm. I don't know. He also checked in a private hospital, not in a public hospital. Maybe feeling that, okay, if I'm in Liberia, I go in the public hospital, chances of me being detected, I'd rather go somewhere else. Which brings another element about the middle class and how this conversation also needs to refer to the role of the middle class in how we respond to epidemics.
Okay. You want to take a bite at this apple?
Sure, yeah, I would agree with my colleagues at the table here. I think denialism certainly has played a significant role in the HIV epidemic and is still something that we work to try to address through education and working very closely with the communities and with the healthcare workers. You know, there had been denialism within healthcare workers as well. We've seen it in the, as Lucille said, in many other outbreaks. I know in Nigeria there had been I think it was a Twitter message that had gone out that kind of spread like wildfire, that if you used salt water, if you drank salt water, it would protect you and cure you. So we had people getting very ill until we were able to, through the EOC, stop that. So I
EOC?
The Emergency Operations Center. So I think there's education to about the disease itself, whatever that disease might be, so that people understand it better. And there are a variety of avenues for providing that, such as social media, as well as the community-based groups and door-to-door campaigns.
It also highlights, and you talked about the right information, but how do you communicate it?
Yeah.
And that is so important to get right. And I really want to pay tribute to the media, the press, with regard to the AIDS epidemic. they communicated the information and they kept the subject alive and they kept communicating what was possible and what should be done. And that information really got to everybody. They were dogged, they were persistent, they were fearless as well, along with some pretty good NGOs that supported them. But that communication campaign, I think, is what got ordinary people everywhere to better understand and to know their rights as well. Because quite often the response of to epidemics is to say, well, you know, you don't get that. And in fact, people do have a right to health, and they have a right to demand it. And, you know, part of our communication is to make sure that people understand that.
I'll just highlight one important point.
Okay.
We always think about civil society and the private sector and agriculture, but actually media are a very important, are a critical component of outbreak response. It's how you reach the people you need to reach. And you know, media have different agendas. The sub-editors put some nice headlines. They don't always convey the right message, but they're a critical part. They're not just about your enemy that they're going to convey bad news. They're critical to bring into outbreak response.
So let's stay on communication for a bit, because if you listen to David Navarro's sort of tick list of what we needed to do, communication is one of those things. And that was certainly in the SARS outbreak, communication, the formal communication with the Chinese government was initially silence and hiding. There was a flip when they actually got called out in public by the director general, and they flipped and they really got forward with the official communication. You got the media, the formal, the established media. You have social media. In it's been reported, you may know, I don't know, but 58 million Nigerians heard first that there was Ebola in Nigeria, not from the Ministry of Health, but from social media. And some studies in West Africa are that the people using social media trust what's on social media more than they trust what's in the sort of established media. And it's things like the fact that the salt, the wrong stuff that'll actually kill you. The last part of the question is this messaging. Because Guinea, when they started their communications, the communication was Ebola kills. Well, son of a gun, 50% of people who go and get treated survive. So they reframe the messaging. So any sort of reflections on particularly the kind of getting the message right early on, and also this challenge of social media, because it turns out to be Ebola was a huge boost. It set social media Twitter records, the highest Twitter accumulation, whatever, in a 24-hour period. So any thoughts on that, on the communication side of things? Nancy, are you? No, I didn't know whether that, I don't want to pull you in if you're not ready yet, but yeah, go ahead, Lucille.
I've done quite a lot, and it's really about getting out there early. Even if you don't know everything, you say what you do know. You never lie, you will always get caught out, and if you lie, nobody will trust you. And you have to give some good news. Something that people can use to protect themselves. So, you know, you're all going to die, but you won't die if you do 1, 2, and 3. And simple messaging, not too many messages. Social media, well, I think it's a double-edged sword.
Yeah.
I was going to say pretty much the same as what you were saying. Do it quickly and tell the truth. And don't be frightened. And if you make a mistake, don't worry. You can fix it. You can correct your mistakes. We spend, you know, as bureaucracies, far too much time trying to get the perfect statement that will create happiness for everybody. Well, you can't do that with an epidemic. Yeah. So just be prepared. You get it wrong, but just tell the truth for heaven's sake and tell it quickly.
Yep. Carl?
Just to add to that, there's also the definition of the audience, because often you realize that the messaging of it kills helps in terms of fundraising. And at which point do you stop the conversation about looking after the money and actually ensuring that the people get the right message? And at some point, I remember when looking at the numbers from the World Bank about the economic impact of Ebola in West Africa, it never reflected the size of the economies of his countries. It's about 0.1% of the GDP of Africa, and they were talking about billions. It's not possible. If you take Liberia, the majority of the money from Liberia comes from remittances. Of course, there'll be more money coming into Liberia in the time of crisis. You know, they don't import much, they don't export much. So I think the messaging part, yes, who are we trying to target?
Mm-hmm. And I think with that, being able to constantly reassess what your message is, what its impact is on that community that you're messaging to, and continuously modifying your message so that you're getting the right message across. Not just in terms of the truth, but you might need the right parts of the truth. Like, for example, with Ebola, you know, we know that Ebola has come from humans who come in contact with certain animals. But in Nigeria, we didn't need to message to people to stay away from bats and don't eat bushmeat. We needed to message to them about proper hand washing and symptoms to watch out for and burial techniques. All of those are truths, but we needed to pick the truths that were necessary for that outbreak at that time.
And Nigeria was a good example of a country that sort of kept track of what was being asked and the questions and the responses and updating the messages. How did that happen?
That was through the Emergency Operations Center. Within the Emergency Operations Center, we had all of the necessary technical teams working on the response, from the epidemiology surveillance team to the clinical care team to the communications team. And so within that team, we had a social media component. We met regularly with the media through the incident managers and the Minister of Health. And we implemented community-based campaigns, education campaigns. And again, when I say we, I'm not talking about myself specifically, but that coordinated interagency response led through the government there.
Okay. So let's look forward and say, okay, what do we need to do in each country and globally to keep local outbreaks from becoming major epidemics? A key part of that is the international health regulations. The SARS epidemic really got the conversation heated up at the World Health Organization, and the international health regulations have the authority of international law, and they were strengthened although the conversation, talk about delay, the conversation to strengthen the international health regulations so we really could protect. It was a little bit like having, I won't go into that analogy, never mind. The conversation started in 1995 at the World Health Assembly to get international health regulations that were substantive, that had teeth. Talk kept happening. 2003, SARS comes out, and then the talk really starts moving. And in 2005, we have the current international health regulations, which went into effect in 2007. But only one out of three countries is up to the standard there. And it's in some ways analogous to drug regulations. Imagine that if only one third of the countries had even the standards in place, it's enough problems where they are, but not even having them in place. So Lucille, South Africa is one of the countries, by the way, in Africa, unless something's changed in the last few days, there isn't a single country who meets the international health regulations. Lots of countries that are compliant with international good manufacturing practices for pharmaceuticals, but not a single country, correct me if I'm wrong, that is yet compliant with the international health regulations. But South Africa is one of the ones that's leading on that. And
I'm not sure we've complied with everything. We're working towards things. But there are a number of them. It's quite a lot in place.
And can you tell us first a little bit about maybe how they work? Because I'm sure for a lot of people this is just a bureaucratic term.
It's kind of a legally binding requirement for member countries to have systems in place to prevent, detect, and report on diseases that may be of regional or international concern with a chance for spread. So the old ones used to report only on a very small number of diseases like smallpox, yellow fever, polio, cholera, but the current ones are really any threat of a certain nature. There's a risk assessment if something happens for this to be reported and responded to. But it's quite an intensive process. It needs to be a lot in place, and I think countries really can't always comply. It's a huge document with lots and lots of tick boxes.
Can I ask, what is it? Is it that they're not? It's just plain not possible to do it. That there's not the funds. That there's not the commitment. I mean, because it's a little bit unsettling that.
I'll tell you what the problem.
Okay.
Is. She just said it's a big, thick document. The problem is there are another 20 like it.
Yeah.
And so the health ministry, you know, how do we comply with all these 20 thick documents? In fact, they can't. So you actually have to rather look at how can these international health regulations be integrated into a broader approach, and that really gets to health system strengthening. It's about having a strong health system, and part of being strong is being able to react appropriately to the threat of epidemic. And there are jolly good guidelines sitting there in that big thick document, but make it part and parcel of everything else so that you lift the whole system. And we learned that with AIDS. You couldn't just have a vertical response to AIDS and think that was going to work. You had to get the whole system to support that response, and it had to deal with other things like TB, for example, and everything else. So you can't see it in isolation.
So integrate, take the international health regulations, and where you can integrate into the health system and the regular formal health system, you think that will increase the number of countries that can comply?
I think make it more doable, but you know, countries do have limited resources in every way, and so. For a number of the requirements, you know, they're not always possible. So I think perhaps they need to look at stage one, stage two, stage three, instead of the whole tick box. They are currently being revised. So certainly there were some weaknesses identified following from Ebola. Perhaps the national department.
Getting down to what's important.
Colleagues from the ministry would want to say anything.
Okay. Just introduce yourself from the Department of Health, South Africa.
Good afternoon. My name is Patrick Munasa. I'm from the National Department of Health. I'm representing Dr. Flu Benson, who's in Botswana at the moment. I think exactly what Professor Bloomberg is saying and Dr. Brink, I think it's important. I mean, I think earlier on, Dr. Nombalo also spoke about this. We need to keep things simple if we want to get traction and we want to get action. Lots of times, and this is not only the international health regulations, especially when these documentation are put together, they're quite complex for countries to be able to comply with. I know we've been busy with trying to meet the requirements of the international health regulations. My colleague sitting next to me here, Dr. Mugello, has also been very hard at work with it. But to get the different sectors of the public sector involved in trying to comply with every specification within that has been a mammoth task for us. Now, you know, just to say that, you know, I think obviously, you know, the capacities within the ministries of health also to be able to do their day job is not necessarily always there. So to have something external to that sometimes is quite complicated. I don't know if Mugela wants to say anything on it quickly.
Yeah, thanks very much. Just to add on, say that exactly what Dr. Brink has been saying, the integration of these regulations into the existing system, as opposed to going vertical. That's one. And then, of course, not forgetting that the different administrative levels, starting from national, provincial, district, and of course coming to the community levels, it's critical that we really focus on the district levels and the community as such. Not leaving them as onlookers, but strategically and see how to structure programs that can involve the community. And that touches exactly what was being said, the issue of community-based disease surveillance and how they can contribute into the detection and prevention, as well as, of course, the effective management of these outbreaks.
Okay, good, thank you. Yeah,
maybe I'll touch on this as well, and maybe bring into it the other piece which has come up in the last year and a half or so, which is the global health security agenda. Mm-hmm. Because, as you mentioned, there are so many countries who have committed to IHR. By the WHO member states, they've committed to achieving IHR, but the international health regulations, but during the specified time frames haven't been able to do that. And some countries are much further ahead than others. Like you said, South Africa is really leading the way in many of the IHR components. But how can we globally help countries, help WHO member countries to achieve IHR? I think that's the question that the Global Health Security Agenda was formulated to try to address. So that there are more than 50 countries that have signed on to work with and partner with countries through the Global Health Security Agenda. The United States is just one of them. And WHO, of course, is at the helm of that. There's a secretariat that's been formed. The U.S. government had been chairing the secretariat up until, I think, that just rotated to another country, and I'm not going to say which one in case I get it wrong.
I think it was with Finland for a while, and then it goes to Indonesia.
Indonesia, yes, sorry. And so with the Global Health Security Agenda, it's really looking at how can we create global partnerships around different components of a framework that will help to achieve IHR, rather than just throwing out this thick document of IHR requirements and saying, you know, here you go. Let's work together, because meeting those requirements for each country is not just beneficial to that country, it's beneficial to all of us. So we should be working together to achieve those.
So let me pick up on that, because the Global Health Security Agenda actually has a number of very practical modules in each of the key areas. And if we look at how we get change in countries and in health areas, so they've got these modules, they're doing it in a few countries, and the idea is whenever you're asking people to do something they've never done before, they spend their time thinking about why they can't do it. But when you actually get some models up and going, is it fair to say that one of the outcomes of the Global Health Security Agenda is, that is a proper acronym, that one of the goals is to get a few, in different programs, different countries, different parts of the world, concrete examples that then show how it can be done more intensively and then become models for others. Is that sort of what they're trying to do?
Yes, that's definitely part of that. And that's where different countries have then signed on to those what they're called action packages. We have all sorts of wonderful terms, but those practical ways that you can work to reach the international health regulations. South Africa has actually signed on to 5 of those. As a co-lead with one of them and as a contributing country and 4 others. So then as countries work towards each of those, they can not just work together, but learn from other countries that might be focused on different ones.
Good. Let me just say, you can mention, but I just want to alert people. We're going to open it up now. Whoever is going to be running around with the mic for questions. Okay, good, Ashley. So let Lucille finish, and then we'll get everyone out there involved. Yes.
Key components of that is what to do about responding to antimicrobial drug resistance. That's not often thought of as an epidemic. It is the biggest threat to health. Strengthening laboratories for early proper detection. Surveillance is the classical one, but it's not always what you think about in terms of outbreaks.
Okay. Okay, Brian.
Before you go to the question, I just want to digress a little bit. You think it's difficult to get the countries to sign up to doing all this work. Can you imagine going to business and persuading them that they need to start thinking about pandemic preparedness? Well, quite honestly, they don't. They actually think it's none of their business and they don't have to worry. And it's another really important example of, well, how can you integrate this into something else that they're doing anyway? And most businesses, hopefully, have done business continuity planning for disruption to the business. And goodness knows there are enough reasons that businesses get disrupted these days. So they tend to have that. And you say, well, within the context of all that, could you start thinking about how a pandemic might impact on your business and start thinking about it? But key for me is that I think we have to get down to metrics, and businesses need to start thinking about health metrics. They need to think about their human capital. They think about all the other capitals, but think about the human capital and start thinking about, in amongst that, you know, health, particularly of your workforce and of their families and of the society within which you operate, because they're your customers or your supply chain. So start thinking about what are those health metrics that are really important. I can tell you one that businesses, in my experience, are all shocking at measuring is absenteeism. Hmm. You go to them and ask them if they can tell you exactly about absenteeism for health reasons, and most of them don't really have it. But then if you start digging and you say, well, was it absenteeism due to injury or to illness? And that's none of our business. We don't want to know about that. Well, actually, it is your business. Yep. And there's a lot you can do as a business to reduce the burden of disease. And that lifts the productivity. It improves your consumer base. It's good for business.
Good. Carl, short, and then we'll
just two quick points. On the integration part, the Global Fund made available to the world between 2002 and 2014, $32 billion for HIV, TB, and malaria. How much of this conversation about integrating those prevention have actually come into what they could have done? The second part is also bringing to the table ministers of finance and ministers of planning, because they are the one who decide on budget allocation, and they're often not at the table. And the last point on that integration, there was a study that was done about 2 years ago on stunting, just to bring to the attention of the ministers of planning that all the plans that you're making for the African countries may not materialize because the people that you expect to be working will not be in a state to actually deliver. And coming back to a point about productivity.
Okay. Questions, comments, experiences to share? Quiet group, yes. In the middle of the back up there. Paul Abali, yes.
The TB epidemic, and I'm not convinced that we are really winning the battle against TB right now. So as we talk about international health regulation, I don't know, what are we not doing right with the TB epidemic in Southern Africa, and particularly South Africa?
Okay, who wants to come in on that?
Start the conversation. So you're absolutely right. It is the number one killer of young people in South Africa, more than HIV. And we have very good drugs, we have new and very good diagnostics, and yet we're not winning. We have ARVs that are being rolled out. Obviously, HIV is an important driver. And it's really about systems and delivering, getting people to being diagnosed, getting them onto treatment, that gap between diagnosis and starting treatment, and keeping them on treatment until they complete. And that's actually where we're falling apart. You can introduce a great new diagnostic test, and we have, but it has not impacted adequately on patient outcomes.
So let me
the whole system.
Let me ask, in a country as diverse as South Africa, usually in these settings you find somebody who's got it figured out. You find a lot of people don't. Are there any shining examples where it is going well? The TB, the two key things, detection and cure.
So I'm a little bit out of the TB. I used to have an old TB.
Anybody really knows. Yeah. First of all, this TB epidemic, a chronic epidemic, it's been with us for generations. The fact that it's still around, there's never been any decent investment in dealing with it. I think that's beginning to change. But slowly, the Global Fund only gives 19% of its money to TB. And a lot goes to AIDS. We talk about AIDS deaths. I think we should stop talking about AIDS deaths. You don't die from AIDS. You actually die from the infection that the immune system, the compromised immune system allowed you to get. So the TB deaths are just critical. And the problem is we don't have good information. We just don't, and TB is difficult to diagnose, so a lot of it just gets missed, especially extrapulmonary TB. So TB is a difficult disease, and one of the things that I think we really are going to have to get much better at if we're going to deal with pandemics, epidemics of these kinds of proportions, we need much better data, but it has to be real-time data. In fact, we need to get to transactional data so that as it's happening, it's being reported. You go and read all these reports, you get about, you know, the best you'll get on TB is what happened in 2012. It's now 2015. What's happened in 2015, I'll tell you in 3 years' time.
Okay, so point on that, yes, please.
I've been told to stand up straight and say my name. I'm Peter Metlapi, I'm with Becton Dickinson, BD. Maybe my question relates to what you just touched on, Brian. I mean, not so much about a question, but let me congratulate, you know, MSH for really, you know, starting this great initiative. I think it's a big opportunity to start doing things, you know, right, and maybe in a very a way that will bring traction to epidemics. You think about, you know, getting the right stakeholders, you know, to go forward from day one. I think we're missing, you know, we spoke about communication, we spoke about media, we're missing that piece. And my advice is MSH should probably be looking at a media or communication partner. You think about the management accounting or advisory firms, you know, for a long time they went on advising all industries across the world, you know, and until they realized that to advise companies like BD, healthcare companies, they need to have doctors in the team. They need to have people who understand that. So for this, you know, end of epidemic initiative to work, I think we need to have media and communication specialists on the round table in the team to be able to simplify those messaging to a six-year-old, you know, to understand, because not everybody understand healthcare. I think if the media fams are having healthcare workers or doctors or nurses who are part of the whole communication team, you know, they'll be able to simplify that message. And I think we'll have a better traction to take that forward with that. Up until now, a lot of initiatives missed out on a number of key stakeholders to really make sure that clarity of that communication, you know, gets home.
That's advice well taken and well received. It sounds like advice and not a question, so that's good. Advice is welcomed also. And any other questions from folks out there? I can keep pushing on the group here. Let me go back to yeah, Brian.
One thing I forgot to say about TB, which what people are thinking, if we really are seriously going to deal with TB, we have to go out and look for it. It's not going to come to us. You've got to go find it. If you don't look for it, you'll report it that it's not a huge problem. When you start looking for it, you will be shocked to find out what is actually out there. And I'll give you a good example in the prisons. You know, they weren't looking for it and they weren't dealing with it. Now they're looking for it and they're shocked at just how much they find. So, and the mining industry equally in TB also needs to, not only in their own workplace, in the communities, and in what they call labor sending areas. You've got a lot of migrant work in Africa. You've got to go out into those far rural areas, into those communities that don't have. And you've got to start looking there, and you'll be shocked what you find.
So let me tie that with the community and the private sector part. One of the biggest paradoxes in global health is that the most common source of health care outside of the household is the drug seller and down the road, and nobody does much about that. Visionary Minister of Health in Tanzania, Gates Foundation, the private sector there, and MSH, over a decade ago, started working with the Ministry of Health to train, license, and monitor the drug sellers. Somebody said along the way, you know, I bet you those people with TB have coughs. and they train these community-based drug sellers to pick it up, and they actually, and you can go to the Lancet, they actually increase their detection rate because that was an issue in Tanzania. What do you think happened? The program got spread to Liberia. What do you think happened with the 750 community medicine shop, accredited medicine shop in Monserrato County in Liberia during the Ebola epidemic? So these are individual shops that are licensed, overseen by the government, but private. They didn't shut down. They didn't run for the hills. They stayed open. They doubled their business during of life-saving prevention and treatment during Ebola, because when people were running away from the hospitals, these community-based shops were still open. And volunteer pharmacy students, because it was linked to the pharmacy professional, came out and worked with these shops on Ebola prevention messages. So just a concrete example of weaving things into the community. Other examples, other questions? We've got time for maybe one more question. Okay, well then what I'd like to do, actually, oh, are there short arms? Okay, go ahead. Stand up, that's fine. Excuse me.
Thank you. I just wanted to know, in your experience from different countries, if traditional healers or doctors have been taken on board to play a part in the fighting the epidemics, as they are very often the first port of call for patients.
I can tell you, in Guinea, the traditional healers were furious they were left out and eventually got pulled in. But I don't know, do you have other examples?
Yeah, I'll kind of go back to my days in Nigeria, not with Ebola, but when I was working there with the HIV program. I think, and I'm going to touch on a slightly different cadre, but the traditional birth attendants, that was a group that, they're very, very utilized within the communities there. And with our HIV program, as well as the maternal child health portfolio, was really important to link up to the traditional birth attendants, to help them to recognize when they should be referring their clients, to be able to come in both for the health of the mother as well as for the health of the child, and for the HIV testing, to educate them on the need for those clients to be able to know their HIV status and link them up to their public health care clinic or a local partner to help with that testing of those clients. Here in South Africa, we know with the HIV response, one of the large government programs is their circumcision program. And we also know, if you just read the papers in South Africa, that there's there's traditional circumcision that takes place within many of the communities, and that there are risks involved that results in the death of many of the initiates on an annual basis. So that's also another area where we've been working to engage with national government and local government and the traditional circumcisers to look at how can we help those communities to still meet their traditional rites of passage, but in a way that's going to be safe for those initiates.
It's such an important point, and you know, my concern is that by tradition, traditional healers have been excluded from the formal health system, and so that's the problem. You don't know who they are or where they are or how qualified they are. They're everywhere, and we really should be doing much more to bring them in. And for example, in South Africa, we have a traditional health practitioners act, but it's never actually been properly implemented. And creating a register and creating the opportunity for traditional healers to function within the health system, I think that that's one of the most important things we have to get right.
So what I'd like to do now is just give each of the panelists one final bite at the apple on just parting comments, particularly thinking about your vision for success of this campaign. You've been kind enough to join us on the launch panel. And what would you see as your vision of success, and any parting advice? maybe we can just start with no, I always put you on the hot seat for it. Brian, why don't you come in and then we'll work our way back here.
Well, I really only have a one-liner. If I was to look at all of this and say what is the single most important thing we have to get right, I think it's the need for better information systems and real-time data in the cloud so that we can be monitoring real-time what's happening out there, and particularly in the primary healthcare system. It's not actually what's happening in hospitals, it's what's happening out there in the clinics.
Okay. Yeah, Lucille?
Yeah, so I think we'd like to endorse this No More Epidemics, but I'd like to see the focus on prevention of epidemics, using this platform, this multi-sectoral approach to prevent epidemics. We've seen the success with polio, towards polio eradication, access to safe water, and improved immunization. So it's really about prevention.
Thank you. For me, it's about community engagement so that individual behavior does not create an outbreak, which becomes an epidemic.
Okay.
And for me, I'm going to say it's about all of those things. It's about preventing, detecting, and responding, and having all countries around the world being able to do those three things effectively, both at a national level, all the way down to the community level. That's the only way that we're going to be able to get to the goal of your program of No More Epidemics.
Great. Let's give the whole panel a warm thank. Let me welcome you back to your chairs, and I just want to introduce the closing commentator. We are very fortunate today to have with us Reva Levinson, who's the founder and president and CEO of KRL International. And Rita's also been a longtime advisor to Africa's first female president, Ellen Sirleaf Johnson of Liberia, and so was very engaged there. And she's actually has a number of different roles, but one of them is as the U.S., the head of the chair of the U.S. Secretariat for the Ebola Private Sector Mobilization Group. So I will turn the microphone, the podium, over to Rita Levinson. Thank you. Welcome her.
Thank you, everyone. And I'm a bit of an accidental closer, as Frank and Ashley know. I'm here in Joburg to participate in the Africa Media Leaders Forum, which is just out by the airport. It's about 650 journalists, 45 countries, looking at best practices and trying to be as good as their counterparts around the world. And I have the privilege this evening to give the award to Best in Class for Healthcare Reporting on Ebola. And then tomorrow, I have the privilege to take Frank and Ashley to these journalists so we can connect a media partner to the MSH partner. So I just wanted to mention that. Yeah. And I wanted to say it's a bit intimidating. I am not a doctor. These are a prestigious panel. I do have a daughter, third year pre-med, who's studying infectious disease. So I have some in my genes, I have some capability. But I'd just like to give a couple minutes of remarks and just first say that it's a privilege to be here. As I said, on behalf of the Secretariat of the Ebola Private Sector Mobilization Group, and also its founder and chair, who most of the MSH people know, that's Dr. Alan Knight. He's based in London with ArcelorMittal, and it is a great privilege to stand in this august place and also to launch the No More Epidemics campaign. So Dr. Brian, right? I wanted to, a lot of my remarks will resonate with you, and I know my colleagues in London wanted to make sure that I extend an invitation to you, to our group, and when I finish, I think you'll know why, because a lot of what I said was echoed by your presentation. But for those of you who are unfamiliar with the EPSMG, it was established in July of 2014 to facilitate a coordinated response, a private sector response to the Ebola virus disease. And at the height of the outbreak, the EPSNG encompassed voluntary participation, 150 public and private organizations, included more than 400 individuals, impacted the lives of 50,000 employees, their families and their communities. And then we had operational groups in Liberia, Sierra Leone, Guinea, and also in Senegal and Mali. So the EPSMG, when we were contacted by your colleagues, was an enthusiastic and early supporter of the No More Epidemics campaign, because we all learned the hard way that no single player, be it government, NGO, healthcare provider, community activist, business, no matter how capable, no matter how capacitized, no matter how motivated, could solve the problem on their own. And again, on Ebola, we all learned the hard way, and one of the lessons learned, I believe, is the No More Epidemics campaign. So the story of the EPSMG, how it was formed, and what it was able to accomplish is illustrated of today's gathering, as it demonstrates the power of collective mobilization, of creativity, innovation, leadership, and that is all definition, we believe, to the No More Epidemics campaign. So I want to applaud you. And for the private sector, for the EPSMG, the No More Epidemics campaign, it's not a nice to have. You know, it's not a do the right thing to secure your contract, your social license to operate. It's not about just being a corporate citizen. The campaign, we believe, is essential to the future of inward and foreign direct investment in these emerging countries. And without healthcare security, there can be no economic security. And without economic security, there can be no national security. So for us, we view this campaign as a material way to mitigate risk for investors and to provide assurances and the confidence that the Ebola outbreak, something like it, something worse, will not happen again. So I'd like to reiterate the campaign slogan, that outbreaks are inevitable, but epidemics are preventable, and we will be prepared. And I urge everyone to make the pledge, those watching, those in those room, and applaud the effort. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I want to thank you for coming here today and taking time out of your busy schedules. There will be some light refreshments in the lobby, and I will invite you all to take the pledge on your way out. Thanks for coming.